Hotel family, back with the amazing Dr. Oba T’Shaka, our brilliant elder and scholar. And today, he's having a conversation about one of his biggest influences in his work in the sixfold stages of mental freedom, Amilcar Cabral. So welcome back, Dr. Oba T’Shaka, Hotep.
Hotep, glad to be back.
Talk to me about why, I asked you the question over a period of time. I said, you know, every time you do an interview, every time we talk, even if we're not doing an interview, you mention Amilcar Cabral. And I said, why is Cabral so important to you? And so I said, we need to have a recording, an archive of this man's brilliance and what he has done to be basically the icon of revolutionary, right? So talk to me about why is it important for us to know who this man is? Who is Cabral?
Yeah, it's extremely important. Amilcar, A-M-I-L-C-A-R, C-A-B-R-A-L, Amilcar Cabral. If you were white, you'd know, because you would know that if he was, let's say, General Douglas MacArthur, most people know who General Douglas MacArthur was. You know what I mean? One of the better generals that this country produced in the 20th century until he got too old to lead and was still leading. Or if you're talking politics, we know George Washington. But the truth is, Black people don't know they're great people, not just in Africa, here as well. And so the greatest people could be walking right among you and you wouldn't even know who they are.
Oh,
in the case of Amilcar Cabral, anyone who is serious about changing society, anybody who's serious about revolution in the 20th century, and particularly who is knowledgeable of movements and leaders in the 50s or 60s or even 40s, would generally know who Amilcar Cabral is. Uh-huh. And so why Amilcar Cabral? I'm not going to go into the details to support that right now. I'll make an assertion and then I'll back it up. People will notice with me, I back my stuff up. I don't do smoke. You know what I mean? So I'm going to just say this. In the 20th century, Amilcar Cabral is the best leader produced in the world. I want you to note what I'm saying here. I didn't say best Black leader. He's Black. He's Guinean. He's an African. But best leader means he's not just best among Blacks. He's best in the world. Mao Zedong is a great leader of the Chinese Revolution, led hundreds of millions of people, freed his country from colonialism. He's great, a great leader, and a great thinker. He beats him. And you'll see why when we go into a discussion of what he accomplished. There's a great leader in Vietnam, Ho Chi Minh, who I must say in terms of character, Cabral and him are about equal because Ho Chi Minh was a great human being, not just a great political military leader. As I pointed out before, he was inspired by Marcus Garvey. That's what got him to go back and lead his movement for freedom in Vietnam. So in terms of character, they're close to equal. When Ho Chi Minh died, you could put all his possessions in a duffel bag. And what's that telling you? He was about his people. Even when the French came and took over, came back after World War II to try and take over, he had been elected president of Vietnam. He was in his 60s, he took a typewriter and a knapsack and went into the mountains with the revolutionaries and into the jungles, you know what I mean? So on terms of character, they're about equal, but in terms of how we rate leadership across the board, political, in terms of being able to organize, intellectual, in terms of being a creative thinker, military, in terms of being an effective military leader, internationally, in terms of being a diplomat, no one matches this. Castro's great. Can't touch him. Wow. Malcolm X was great, and you know how much I think of Malcolm, and so was Garvey. Can't touch him. Nobody. Ella Baker, can't touch him. He's on the top of the top, and if you had him, if he was alive today, he wouldn't say that. He was too humble and might not even think that, just as Theophilo Benga might not say that maybe he's as good or better than Sheikh Anta Diop. I would. He wouldn't.
Absolutely.
Now, what does he think? I don't know. But if you look at the record, I could prove it. So the point is, the reason why he's so important is his diversity, his complexity, his brilliance, and his accuracy. And you'll see when we get into him just how he measures up in all those areas. And anyone who's a revolutionary worth anything, especially an African revolutionary, say Cabral, their eyes light up.
Wow, okay.
I'm going to the National Council for Black Studies to do a series of workshops soon. And the head of the National Council of Black Studies, his first name is Shabazz, his last name is Cabral. I said, you're right up my alley. And then he turned out, he was born in the same little town that nobody's born in, Bunky, Louisiana, that my father was born into.
Wow. So I said,
brother, you didn't pick those names by accident. Malcolm X, the most brilliant political mind produced in the U.S. in the 20th century and one of the two best organizers in the 60s in the Black Freedom Movement, one of the very best in the 20th century, and Cabral. So he knows why he picked those names.
Mm-hmm. So, fantastic.
He's bad. Badder than bad.
All right. So
put it another way, before you get in the next question, in the folk culture of African-American people, enslaved blacks carried over on slave ships a real bad brother. He was a mythical brother. He's called High John the Conqueror. You ever heard of him?
No.
In the blues, they call him High John the Conqueror. And he is a warrior spirit. As Zora Neale Hurston, this great anthropologist, said, he was carried in the decks of slave ships and the spirits of Africans. And he was like the baddest of bad. And so when an enslaved mother wanted to scare a child to do right, she'd say, High John's going to get you. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And High John was manifested in the form of Nat Turner, Denmark Vesey, Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth. And in modern terms, Malcolm X and a whole bunch of others. Well, I'd say he's on the level of High John the Conqueror. Except he wasn't mythical, he was real. Bad, better than bad.
So this is huge, because a scholar of your level, this is the honor of honors. So where and when was he born, and why is his first name so important?
He was born September the 12th, 1924, in a place called Bafata, Guinea. And this was a part of a Portuguese colony that included Guinea and Bissau, which is in West Africa, next to Conakry, Guinea, and close to Senegal, and also a part of an island as well. And his name is Amilcar. The name Amilcar is important and was given to him by his father. And it's almost prophetic. It makes you really wonder just how much we know about things when we're not even conscious of them. The name Amilcar comes from Hamilcar. Hamilcar was the father of Hannibal. Hannibal is the greatest general in history, period. Oh. Nobody touches Hannibal. And so his father is Hamilcar, and so Amilcar comes from Hamilcar. So what's interesting is Hamilcar leads the First Punic War, and these are two wars that are fought between the people of Carthage, who are African. Carthage is now Tunisia in North Africa, and the Carthaginians. It was the Carthaginians against the Romans. Carthage was the power. Rome was rising. And so Hamilcar led the first war of the Carthaginians against the Romans. And so when Hannibal takes over from his father, he pursues a lot of his father's policies. So what's interesting is Amilcar would have the name of Hamilcar, and he would come back to his country to lead them in a successful war of liberation against the Portuguese. So wow. You could say, how did the father pick this name? Somewhere he knew something about it. You know, the Europeans say in heaven, we pick our parents. In spirit form, we make these decisions. We have compacts. And when we come to earth, we forget them. And the parents also pick us as children. And so I personally know that's true. I'm into parapsychology and seen a lot of evidence that this is in fact true. Uh-huh. So when you say you black by accident, no, you're not. You made the decision. And you made the right decision too.
That's right.
Why did I make this decision? You made the right decision. And keep on minding that beauty that's inside of you, and you'll find out just how true that is. You
know? Absolutely. Real talk. Now, let's talk about Amilcar's parents and the influence they had on him.
Amilcar's father, his name was Juvenal Antonio da Costa Cabral. Oh, that's a big name.
Absolutely.
The person that had the biggest influence on Amilcar Cabral's life was his father. And the book I'm writing now, I finished tracing Amilcar Cabral's development through his various stages using the Dogon and African American mastery system. And so it's very clear that while his father, Juvenal, would not qualify as a master in the master system, in that you're either an improviser or an innovator, you set up an existing school, but you have something new in it, or you come up with a new school and whatever it is, he was advanced in what he did. And so he left a profound impression on Amilcar Cabral. The first impression he left was, he was a person who was a part of the group that you would call assimilated, except he was not psychologically assimilated, but he was educated by the Portuguese. And only 1% of the Africans went through higher education in the Portuguese colonies. Mm. Only 1%. Mm. That's like nothing. He went for training to be a priest and gave it up. Otherwise, there'd be no Amilcar Cabral, unless he was doing like a lot of these priests do. And not practicing what they're supposed to practice.
Absolutely.
So he was a priest, but the point is he was very smart. He had a rigor when it came to intellectual discipline, and he was into reading and writing. And so most people in Guinea were oral. And so he had that additional appreciation. He was not a revolutionary, but he was a radical and a progressive. And a progressive is somebody who may not be thinking about overturning a system, but what they want is improvement in it. So he was a critic of Portuguese colonialism. And Cabral constantly heard his father's critiques of colonialism. And one of his biggest critiques was that a lot of starvation had occurred in Cape Verdean, where he was from. It's an island next to Guinea-Bissau. Over 50,000 people died of starvation during World War II, just in Cape Verdean, due to the fact that the Portuguese sapped that country of any agricultural resources they had to feed their own people.
Oh.
So he was a critic of that. He was a critic of their policy of what they had were cash crops. And so each African country under colonialism is where the Europeans come in and they establish control, usually through military conquest, and they run the country politically and economically, and sometimes may have an effect culturally. So in the case of the Portuguese, what they did in terms of their colonialism, the cash crop coming out of that country was grown at the expense of food that people could grow. And so he was opposed to a single crop or a few crop economy. He believed in a diversified agricultural system. And as a result, Cabral became an agronomist. So his father's views on agriculture shaped his views around agriculture. His father believed that both Cape Verde and Guinea-Bissau should be unified. And that's not a common belief among Cape Verdeans, especially. So Cabral also believed that. His father was also a poet. Cabral was a poet. And there's an artistic side to Cabral that is very important. So in many ways, Cabral's father was a profound influence on him. And it would appear he was a man of good character. His mother, her name was Iva Penhel Ivora Cabral. They were married when Cabral was born, but later they divorced, and the mother had to raise Cabral on her own under poverty conditions. So Cabral experienced a lot of hunger.
Ooh.
And it grounded him also. It got him to really appreciate what the motives of people were in struggle. And he would always stress this. Remember, this is when he wakes up, because as a child, he was not awake. Remember, the people are not moved by ideas. They're moved by the improvement of their material condition. And then in general, their condition. And so he was always on the point of dealing with the people's needs. And so from his mother, you know, he experienced poverty, but he experienced a mother who loved him, who had good character, and who was very disciplined. And Cabral was himself very disciplined and very hardworking.
Did he have brothers and sisters?
Huh?
Did he have brothers and sisters?
Cabral?
Yeah.
He had a brother, a half-brother, who, which, you know, in Africa, they don't call him half-brother. His brother would become active in the party with him. Louis Cabral, and would, well, I'll get into that later, but his, yeah, he had a brother, and he would, in fact, be very active with him. So those are the two, and they have a profound influence on Amílcar Cabral. And, you know, Cabral would demonstrate many of the qualities of both his parents and throughout his life.
Talk to me about Cape Verde and the influence Cape Verde had on his parents, and then subsequently Cape Verde had an influence on him.
Yeah, now Cape Verde will also remind some blacks of what we faced here, because it's a little different from most parts of Africa. Cape Verde is an island close to Guinea-Bissau, but Cape Verde, the Portuguese, had a lot of physical presence there. And so you have a lot of mixed bloods in Cape Verde, but most important, assimilation. And so what's key about Cape Verde is Cape Verdeans, generally after a couple of generations of colonialism, didn't know their own African language, did not know African culture. And most of them thought they were Portuguese. So the father did not. It was obvious the father was conscious. And I'm not sure about the mother, but it appears that the mother spent a lot of her time in Guinea and was a hardworking African woman. But the point is, Cape Verdeans were assimilated, and they looked down on the people of Guinea-Bissau. They also performed the role as lower civil servants working for the Portuguese. So they worked both in Guinea-Bissau and in Angola and Mozambique, which were their other colonies. So you want to talk about brainwashed and whitewashed, that is generally the Cape Verdean. And so while Cabral was not born in Cape Verde, his parents were, and he's of Cape Verdean descent. He's viewed that way. And many of the early leaders of the party that he recruited were Cape Verdeans, and they were educated in Portuguese stuff. So that's important because it means that Cabral's got something he's faced with there.
When you you mentioned earlier about assimilation, and it's the first of the six full stages to mental freedom. Was Cabral, did he ever show signs of assimilation?
Oh yeah, he was assimilated. Even though culturally assimilated, even though he was raised by a conscious father, as I was, you know, I was assimilated and my father was not, you know what I mean? But his father came from an assimilated island. What we see as evidence of Cabral's assimilated mentality as a child and as a young man is his poetry. If you read his poetry, there's a good side and there's a negative side. The good side is there's idealism in his poetry. He has a poem where a young person from Cape Verde leaves an island and goes out into the world and then comes back to free his people. But everything you read in this poetry, you see that the poet identifies himself as a human being, but not as an African. So the poetry is just one indication of Cabral's identity through assimilation. And it's a common thing with Blacks who are assimilated, they'll say, I'm not African, I'm human. You know what I mean? I'm not Black, I'm human. You know what I mean? And so that's, yes, you are human. And he was a real humanist. It's one of his real great qualities. And so are African people. In fact, a part of being African is being humane and African American. It's our culture. But to not acknowledge your ancestry, that's a sign of a problem. And so, yeah, Cabral had an assimilated mentality as a young man and as a child because of the Cape Verdean ancestry.
Excellent, excellent. Now, he went to university in 1945, is that right?
Yeah.
And I think as an agronomist, he was going to learn agriculture, correct?
Right.
What was happening in history and in his life around that time when he was going to university?
Yeah, Cabral goes to Cape Verde to become an agronomist, an agriculturalist in a class of 300. Only 30 graduate.
Wow.
300. And he's one of the two top ones in his class. So that's a little side note there.
Wow.
Got a scholarship.
That's a big side note.
Yeah. But you see, if that's all we knew about Cabral, if that's all he ever did, we wouldn't care to know anything, and he wouldn't be in the history books because a lot of smart people go to college.
That's true. You know, that's true.
And don't do anything that's worth knowing about. And so plus something else, we wouldn't know about him. What was going on in 1945? When he arrives in Portugal, is the most important meeting that Africans had in the 20th century, the Fifth Pan-African Congress. And that's being held in Manchester, England. And a guy named George Padmore, whose real name was Malcolm Nurse, organized it, and a man named Kwame Nkrumah, who Cabral would later become close to, was a second in influence and organizing. So what's important about this conference is it is the most important meeting that Africans have in the 20th century because Africans are planning the independence of Africa. Now, Pan-African, it's a fifth Pan-African Congress, Pan, all African, all African. The idea of Pan-Africanism is a tenet of African-American culture. It comes out of African-American and Caribbean culture, particularly Trinidadian culture. those two groups of Africans in the diaspora are the leading groups around this idea that Africa should be one Africa, Pan, all Africans are one Africa, and that Africans around the world should unite. And so there's the first Pan-African Congress held in London in 1900 by Sylvester Williams. And then there are four others that are held by W.B. Du Bois. And then the fifth one, you say it should be the sixth. They don't count Sylvester Williams' conference. So Du Bois holds four after the first one and is honorary chair of the fifth Pan-African Congress, but it's organized by Malcolm Nurse, George Padmore, and secondly, with the help of Kwame Nkrumah. So he knows that Africans are plotting independence.
Uh-huh.
Then after that, Nkrumah leaves and is brought back to Ghana and leads the first successful independence movement in West Africa. The first one in the 20th century was occurred in the Sudan. So Cabral would later call Nkrumah the genius of African independence, meaning he was able to lead a movement for independence and gain it without bloodshed. So he considered that genius.
Uh-huh.
So Cabral knows that, and it fills the air because this is right after the end of World War II. He also knows the Vietnamese are rising up, and he knows that there's a revolutionary ferment going on in the world. So this is a background. Now he's coming to Portugal that's under a dictatorship, a fascist dictatorship. So while he's coming on a scholarship and he's able to go to a university, it's under heavy, as the Jamaicans would say, heavy manners. And it's being enforced by a very vicious regime that is also clamping down heavily on the colonies, including Guinea-Bissau, Cape Verde, and Angola and Mozambique. So that's kind of the background. Independence is in the air, and Cabral is coming into a new era that has to have an influence on him. And he's a young man.
Mm. So roughly around how old is he?
He's in his early 20s, about 23.
Yeah. So he's going through his own assimilation, but how did he see and begin to have a view of those Africans who were dealing with their assimilation?
This is extremely important because he comes in thinking he's Portuguese. Can you imagine? But then, as Malcolm said, in his assimilation, he thought he was white.
Mm-hmm.
And if you recall that young girl that was on this Dr. Oz, what's this guy that worked for Oprah?
Dr. Phil?
Yeah, Dr. Phil. It was funny. She said, "Black as midnight. I'm not black. I'm not African. Look at me. I don't have black ears."
Unbelievable.
So it was so sad. It was funny. And it really wasn't funny.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, Cabral thought he was Portuguese. And so what he sees, though, as he becomes aware, he sees that assimilation is a policy carried out by the Portuguese.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a policy that affects only, as I pointed out, 1% of the blacks, of the Africans. And what happens with assimilation is the assimilated person is admitted to university training, takes on Portuguese identity, and is taught to look down on their own people, that thinks that Africans are inferior and Europeans are superior. So part of what Cabral comes to see is assimilation is based on the premise of racism, and is based on the premise that African culture is inferior to European culture. Uh-huh. And so he begins to see that this is a game, that this is a game that the Portuguese and other Europeans create to cream off a certain group of Africans to serve them.
Uh-huh.
And then he also comes to see that This deal is sealed through privilege. So if you really think about the most brainwashed blacks in the U.S., very often the Ivy League colleges are the ones where the greatest amount of brainwashing occurs. Why? Well, because first of all, these are the seats of power for those who will manage the system for the rich who run this country. And so they're given privileges. And when you go to these universities, you're living in comfort. And you're promised comfort when you come out. And if you are able to translate a degree to a job, then you end up in a comfortable position. Mm-hmm. And I know people like this, we all do. And you know what I mean? Some of them end up working for these hedge funds, making $200,000, you know? No, many of them sever contacts with their parents. Mm-hmm. You know? And they think that they're better. And so Cabral sees that this is a trap that the colonists have created, and later he'll see other things. So this is a part of what he's going through. He's beginning to see what assimilation, which is what he is, really is.
So how did Cabral's assimilation compare to your assimilation?
He's coming out of a Portuguese situation where he's coming from an island where everybody has been assimilated both through intermarriage and through brainwashing, through being cut off from your language, your history, and your culture. And of course, we come out of a country where this has occurred through enslavement. And so in my particular case, and I'm of course coming after slavery, mine comes through miseducation through the public schools. I'm going through schools where I have nothing but white teachers and the media and everything else, stereotypes. My parents are giving me one message. The system is giving me another. And in some ways, this is similar to what Cabral faces, because Cabral's father, while he had come out of an assimilated group, he himself wasn't assimilated. He was a critic of Portugal. You know, my father was too, but I didn't get the message. So in a lot of ways, it's similar. You know what I mean? It's similar. And in the case of Cabral, he's cut off from his language and a knowledge of his history. And of course, we are too, except we end up creating Ebonics. And they also end up creating a pidgin Portuguese, just as there's a pidgin Creole. It's called Creole. And it was pretty soon, when they wage an armed struggle, they use it to communicate with different ethnic groups. So there is a similarity in that. In my case, I wasn't conscious that I was being assimilated. In Cabral's case, he wasn't conscious of how assimilation worked. And so when he begins to really look at it and begins to see how an elite is created, and how this idea of seeing yourself as superior because you're identifying with your oppressor is based on racism. So he's beginning to see it that way. That's at least the beginning of what, you know, turns him around. So very similar, even though in different circumstances.
So another stage in the sixfold stages is disturbance, pre-disturbance and disturbance. At what point did Cabral move from assimilation to disturbance?
It's a part of his awakening process. And so as he's undergoing awakening, he's getting exposed to literature that is exposing assimilation. And this literature, a lot of this literature is coming from publications like a publication called Presence African. And if you recall, Leonard Jeffries was referring to this publication and how one of the leaders in that publication was a major influence on Sheikh Amad Diop and was a major influence on him. So Presence African is pushing African consciousness. So he's getting exposed to information that is exposing how assimilation works. And he's also in Portugal. So he's getting exposed to Portuguese racism. And so it's a combination of these things. And then his view of assimilation, he's beginning to see it's based on a false premise, because as he begins to get exposed to his history, he's discovering that this idea that Africans are inferior, that their culture is inferior to Europeans, is false. And so this is a part of his disturbance experience. He begins to realize that this is false and that he's been brainwashed. And this is part of his awakening experience. So it's, you know, it's a key part.
So let's talk about the experiences that triggered Cabral's mindset to become African.
This is very important. Cabral becomes a part of an African study group, which is interesting because Cabral was one thing in the classroom and another thing in private. He was able to separate his life from his official academic life and then what became his political life. And so the Portuguese weren't really aware of what was going on, but a series of Portuguese colonial subjects that came from Angola, Mozambique, and Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde formed a study group. And these would become the leaders of Mozambique and Angola. So a man named Agostinho Neto from Angola would be a part of this study group. The people who took part in this called this Cabral's generation. So Cabral was the leading influence in this study group. And so it's in this study group that Cabral begins to study African history. And the person that exposes him to it is Leopold Senghor. Leopold Senghor is the leader of the Negritude movement. And in French-speaking Africa, that's comparable to what we would call the African-centered movement here. And Leopold Senghor later becomes president of Senegal. And so Senghor was a poet. And so Cabral, his first exposure to African history is through poetry, and Cabral's a poet himself. But as he begins to discover the history, he begins to see the lies of the colonizer. He begins to see that Africans, and I'm paraphrasing him, but he's saying, have great history. He's beginning to see that Africans have beautiful cultures. He's beginning, and I'm paraphrasing exact points he made, he's beginning to see that Africans had complex, beautiful cosmologies and philosophies. Now, what's this telling you? He's beginning to do a deep dive into the thought pattern of African people, not just the great achievements. The achievements are important, but he is beginning to reorganize his mindset, his philosophy, and his thought pattern. You can see this. He's going through that first phase that I described in the sixfold stages to mental freedom of romanticism, because when he describes his awakening, he's talking about how amazed he was at the great achievements of African people, how beautiful these achievements were. And then they begin a Pan-African study. So they're studying literature and history from blacks in the U.S. They're studying literature and history and politics and culture of blacks from Brazil, who are colonized also by the Portuguese, and Cubans. There's a great Cuban poet that they particularly liked, a guy named Guillion. So it's also a Pan-African orientation, and he's talking about how Africans all over the world have a common agreement, you know, on their history, on their politics. So this is a real profound change that he's undergoing. And to some degree, it's a profound change for those who are coming from other Portuguese colonies. I say to some degree because based on how they led their movements, Agostinho Neto, for example, you would have to question how deeply they underwent their transformation. But clearly, Cabral was undergoing deep transformation. And
how old was he at this time of between his assimilation phase and his disturbance stage? Was he still in college at this time?
Yeah, he's still in Portugal as an agronomy student. This is during that period. It's the late 50s. This is, really key for Cabral, is this transformation. Now, in the African identity stage and the disturbance stage, we can see contradictions, for example, particularly disturbance. When you're in the disturbance stage, you're angry, you want to strike out. Cabral, it wasn't just anger with Cabral. Cabral was clear at an early period that he planned to go back to Guinea and help his people be free from Portugal. Uh-huh. But the thing about assimilation and African identity is there's also contradictions. You can talk African and sometimes practice what isn't always African. Cabral's girlfriend is a Portuguese woman. He marries her. And she is an agronomy student and one of the best. Cabral helps tutor her, and she graduates. She's one of the 30 out of 300 that graduated and later goes back to Guinea with him. That's his first wife. Africans have a different attitude about marriage outside of their race than we do. They ain't race conscious to begin with. So we should read this a little differently.
Yeah.
But it's interesting, later Cabral would marry an African woman. So that would tell you something else is going on in this transformation. So it's clear Cabral is going through a deep transformation. He's reading, he's studying, and later on he's engaging with Africans from Guinea-Bissau and from the Portuguese colonies who are sailors who are working on ships, everyday people, and exchanging with them. So there's a real conversion that Cabral is undergoing.
Now, in terms of his going through this evolution, his role in African culture in the awakening process versus the role that was in the struggle of the national liberation, how did that play upon his awakening?
Yeah, this is very important, and we've discussed in the sixfold stages to mental freedom, and I hope people really get this. There must really be something to the sixfold stages of mental freedom that you can...
For me, it's the archetype. It is the absolute unequivocal archetype of moving into African consciousness and African revolutionary consciousness. There is no other model or framework that I have studied, that I have heard of, that I know of, that I've talked to people, other elders and scholars. This is it. And so it's one of the reasons why I wanted to have many, many conversations with you about this. I know you're working on your next masterpiece on mastery, and Amilcar Cabral is going to be a part of that, talking about the Dogon philosophy and what have you. But everything for me, when we started talking, was sixfold stages. And I saw myself in the data. I saw myself in the experience. And it was an immersion process. So I really want the community, the family, to use this as their model for revolutionary consciousness, to pull them up and out of the situation and the mindset and the communities that they are currently in, that they are locked into assimilation and just Black identity. So these conversations are critical.
Yeah, so this is a practice. This is not a theory.
Right.
New theory. Theory's a guess. Universities do hypotheses. I don't do hypotheses. Those are guesses. So this comes from practice, having gone through it. And so when you can take somebody who just happens to have become the greatest leader in the 20th century, but anyone, and you can show that they've gone through certain stages that you've already laid out, you know this works. And so for no doubt, people should really get this point. The last discussion we had was on Malcolm's transformations. He went through the same thing. Now, certain people start at assimilation. Certain people start at Black identity here. Certain people in Africa started African identity. But either way, it fits. So this is, key point. Now, Cabral makes the point that while culture is necessary for what he calls this mental conversion. I call it reconstruction of the black mind, where the mind changes from white to African. While it's necessary, you have to immerse yourself in your culture, your history, your politics, all of this. It's not sufficient. Why? Because if you don't practice it, it's just in your head, going nowhere. And so the point he's making is that it's only when you join the people in struggle that if you're one who's been assimilated, that you will complete the African identity process, because it's through interacting with everyday people, as well as formerly assimilated people who wake up, that you are able to complete your awakening process. And I really want to stress this. Cabral saw this as the key methodology for breaking the problem of brainwashed African leaders. This, because, and it was biographical, because he saw it broke it for him. It was, it enabled him to have a free mind and a free spirit. He was already a good person. And so he saw this as the key piece of medicine that you needed to take a group of people who might lead a liberation struggle the wrong way if they still have these seeds of elitism that they're superior to the people. And so they had to be involved in a day-to-day struggle where they were interacting with the people so their mindset would be changed. And so this is the real key point. And Cabral does not complete his awakening process until he engages in the liberation struggle in Guinea-Bissau and for Cape Verde. It's only then, and it's a continual process. So this is real key.
So how does Cabral's idea about the impact of the liberation struggle on African consciousness compare to your experience in the sixfold stages?
Cabral's awakening occurs through study group. My awakening occurs through struggle. So Cabral, through a study group, undergoes an awakening, begins to examine his history and culture, and then through various steps gets involved in an armed struggle. At first isn't armed, but he gets involved in a struggle with his people that becomes an armed struggle. Mine starts in the struggle, an awakening that occurs in the struggle, and then it forces me to have to go back and hit the books while I'm in struggle, which isn't easy, because if you're in a struggle, you don't have as much time to read, but it becomes also a necessity. But the similar thing is, mine isn't completed without engagement and struggle. And what that means for me is being engaged with all kinds of black folks. Kwame Ture, who's a good friend of mine, formerly Stokely Carmichael, he made this comment. He learned to love himself by everyday black people in Mississippi. Now, I'm sure his parents taught him to love himself, but it was a different kind of love that he learned in those red roads in Mississippi. You know what I mean? These are basic black, Mississippi black, Mississippi strong. You come out of Mississippi, you coming out of hell. And these are people who are some of the most loving, kind people on the planet. My grandmother came from Mississippi. The most loving person, even more so than my mother, than I ever knew. You know what I mean? Mississippi. But the point is, through engaging in struggle, it's everyday people who are teaching you. Who woke me up? Norman Brown, who's still my good friend. In fact, when I go to this conference, Norman will probably drive me to the airport. Anytime I need anything, I say, hey, Norman, can you do this? Or I'm usually going somewhere and don't know how to get there. Hey, Norman, how do I get here? And then we party together, you know what I mean? And he's 2 years older than me. But the point is, Norman's got a high school education. Norman's one of the smartest people I know, you know what I mean? And so the point is, it's that interaction. And it's that interaction that keeps you out of arrogance. It keeps you out of thinking you're better than somebody else. And it also saves your behind, because you'd be surprised, you know, in ancient Kemet, they had a saying that wisdom could come even from the woman in the marketplace. And there's a story in ancient Kemet of the eloquent peasant who's a farmer who's been ripped off by a person of nobility. And he goes before the Pharaoh and pleads his case. And the Pharaoh lets him continue to testify because he's teaching Ma'at. And he's teaching that this noble person, he may have power. He may come from some royal line, but he's not got, he's got no royal character. So it's everyday people. So the Pharaoh's allowing him to teach so that those who are high and mighty might get a message. So struggle is absolutely essential. So in the sixfold stages to mental freedom, if all you do is read and study and you don't do any work, it's just going in one ear and out the other. It will be a talk without walk is going nowhere. And so it's a constant thing of working on yourself. It's internal, spiritual, and it's external. It's political. Whatever you do in your community, you got to do something to take this knowledge and use it to help other people. And so that's what Cabral meant, and he's absolutely right. And he hoped that the struggle for national liberation combined with the transformation of the mindset would be the difference that would enable him to produce a kind of leadership that would serve the people rather than oppress them. So that's what he hoped. But that was definitely what he practiced.
Fantastic. Thank you for that, Dr. Oba T’Shaka. The Dogon system of 4 degrees of transformation and mastery, partly the book that you're working on right now, where did Cabral fit into your own mastery, and how did he influence you?
Yeah, when I underwent my awakening in 1963, Cabral is now in the early stages of organizing his own movement, and we didn't know about him. I didn't know about Cabral until late 60s and then early 70s. And so my first two masters, Garvey and Malcolm, they're my first two masters, and they're in my reality. But the level of transformation that Cabral affected, or at least played, you know, in terms of my life, was the level of Boloso. In the Dogon system, Jiriso and Beniso, these are the introductory levels where you imitate. And when this book comes out, we'll go into this in great detail. Boloso is the level in African-American culture that we call improvisation. And in Dogon culture, Boloso, it means synthesis. And in African-American culture, it usually means assimilation, meaning bringing together, if you're a musician, different sounds and then adding something of your own. And that's improvisation. Or bringing together different political ideas, if you're a political thinker, and adding something of your own, that's, you know, improvisation. Or in science or whatever area you're in. The thing about a Boloso master is you don't imitate a Boloso master. So because it, you're not at the level of imitation. So in the case of Cabral, I didn't imitate him. But the reason why I picked him, and under Boloso, you're studying many different masters. You're studying many different things. It's not just one person. But the thing is that Boloso person, at the stage of Boloso, there is often, not always, but often, a person who is like the major influence. And that means that person usually has a multifaceted influence, meaning it's multiple. And so in the case of Cabral, in the case of Malcolm, I was drawn to Malcolm because he was both a thinker and an organizer and a good person. I was drawn to Amílcar Cabral because he was a thinker, he was an organizer, He was a strategist. He was a military leader. And he also engaged in diplomacy. And he was a master in all these areas. And so in my case, as I'm moving to the level of Boloso, I'm developing my own thoughts. And so I'm not copying Cabral. And there's a reason, because our conditions are unique. But he provides a model for originality. And we're similar in this respect, and it's also true with Ella Baker. I'm a situational thinker in part, which means the sixfold stages of mental freedom come from the experience of the situation of waking up. And so through going through those stages, I've experienced those situations. And so when you put forward ideas like that, you tested them, they work. And so Cabral was a situational thinker. And so it was similar, but I wasn't conscious of that at that point. I wasn't copying him in that way. But the point is, it was similar. But the point is, his thoughts were original. That's a key point. And they worked. I'm not into armed struggle. We're not capable of carrying out an armed struggle, but I appreciate the methods he used and looked at them and studied them, and war is one of the things I study. So Cabral was a master at this, and he was in charge of all the military operations inside of Guinea-Bissau. Cabral was a diplomat. And so he organized the internationalization, getting international support in the world. And as an organizer, as I evolved and developed, then I began to engage in international kinds of work. First around African liberation support. So from 1972 to around 1979, a group that I formed in 1966 that became known as Pan-African People's Organization, we would organize African Liberation Days as part of a national movement. The largest one was held in Washington, D.C. when it kicked off in 1970. But the largest ones after that were organized by Pan-African People's Organization, 25,000 to 30,000 people a year. And we got money from that, and we got supplies from that, and we sent it to PAIGC, Cabral's organization. We sent it to Mozambique, Angola, and the other armed struggles in Africa. And then I spent time on the African continent working in Ujamaa villages and then chairing the sixth Pan-African Congress and interacted with liberation group movements in Tanzania. So Cabral provided a nice example of how to move in terms of getting support. Again, I wasn't following his example because our situation's different, but we were moving along similar paths. Uh-huh. And it was a path of excellence as far as Cabral's concerned. And so he always gave me that idea. And then there were certain other things that I'll get into in a minute that really distinguish him, that really impressed me most of all. I'll get into it in a minute. So overall, similar path. And so he was at a high level of mastery, respected it, and wanted to learn about it.
Now, in 1953, the governor general of Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde asked Cabral to conduct the first agricultural survey in the history of Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde. Why was this survey so important?
Yeah, this is one of the things that makes Cabral the most brilliant political thinker. Now, I'm going to tell you, a lot of Marxists, particularly white Marxists who have written about him, don't think he's a very original thinker. And that's because he's not a scripted thinker. He's not a theoretician, somebody who puts out a grand theory. He's a situational thinker. So his ideas are always based on experience. What's important about this is Cabral is now an agronomist. He's actually a hydraulic engineer. And it's interesting because Guinea-Bissau's main crop is rice. And so that skill as a hydraulic engineer would be useful with a rice crop. But The point is, Cabral has two faces. One face, he's a nice guy. And he's now in Guinea-Bissau doing agricultural work with his first wife. And so the governor general likes him. He doesn't know this guy's fierce nationalist. This guy is thinking about how can he organize his people to shoot as many Portuguese soldiers as he can to shoot them out of his country. And so he's a nice guy. So the governor general of Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde, he asked him to do an agrarian survey. There had never been a survey of the state of agriculture in Guinea-Bissau. And so Cabral does it, brings his wife and gets a number of assistants. Now, what he does, this takes a number of months. So he's surveying the agriculture. Now, if that's all he did, that would be great. We wouldn't be talking about it. But because he's two people, what else does he do? He studies how the people are organized across Guinea and Guinea-Bissau. Oh. It's called social structure. It's called how are people organized from the lineage to the extended family to the village to that whole society. How are they organized? How do they make decisions? Who's in charge of what? I mean, what's the relationship of men to women? You know what I mean? And so he goes across Guinea and so in Guinea-Bissau and he's asking questions. He doesn't have to do this with Cape Verde. They're assimilated. He's not doing agrarian study. Their agricultural system is very weak. And so he constructs an analysis of the social structure of Guinea-Bissau that is the best analysis done by any revolutionary in the 20th century. And if that's all he did, it would make him the most brilliant social, political analyst. So this is extremely...
How old was he around this time now?
He's in his 30s now.
Well, he was his first wife. Did he have kids?
I don't know. That's a good question. I don't know. Now, the thing is, Cabral, in organizing at this point, getting this social structure thing together, this becomes the basis for how he organizes the armed struggle. Oh. And without it, he would not have had the success that he had in his organizing. And no other leader has had this appreciation. Now, you can say, oh, it's a small country, only 800,000, easy. Size is not what determines it. He had a diverse social structure to look at. So he had two contrasting groups and a lot in between. The two contrasting was, one was called Fula, F-U-L-A. These were Muslims. And they had chiefs. Europeans call them chiefs, kings. And while all of them had fought against the Portuguese, there was a 90-year struggle against the Portuguese by Africans all over Guinea-Bissau. 90 years before they were able to finally win. That occurred across Africa. 100 years in the 19th century, Africans fought colonialism. So if anybody thinks that the white people just walked in with their Bibles and took over, they are sadly mistaken. They should be happily mistaken. So each of these people have fighting traditions. But the thing is, with the Fula chiefs make a compromise with the Portuguese. And so they're given certain privileges. And they're not assimilated, but they play a role almost the same that the assimilated play. And so the people that can't really do anything unless their chiefs are approved. So in most Fula societies, those Fula societies did not support the armed struggle. Some did, most of them didn't. But the group that he found that was most supportive were a group called Balantes, B-A-L-A-N-T-E-S. These were what you call classless age grade societies. Most of us, when we study African history, we're only interested in the kings and queens. Well, most of us that got enslaved didn't come from kings and queenly societies. A lot of us came from these small societies, and they were preyed on by the kings and queens, the ones with the big armies. And so these Belante, everybody has a say-so among the Belante. Among the Belante, they have age-grade societies, so divisions are made according to age and responsibility. So they had what they call, in the Portuguese, homo grandes, elders that were respected. So you had to get past the homo grandes. But the fact is that the everyday people had the major say-so, and women had a significant role within that. So Cabral appreciated that. And then when he begins to train his cadres, he has new people coming in who know about some ethnic groups better than he does, and he integrates that into how he approaches organizing. So his study of social structure is the best done by any revolutionary in the 20th century.
Wow, that's amazing. That is incredible. So what led Cabral to organize PAIGC, and what was the big mistake that he made and the party in organizing this whole thing?
Yeah, in 1958, he organizes PAIGC, which is the Party for the Independence of Guinea and Cape Verde. And again, you see the father's influence, because he's pushing for both Cape Verde and Guinea-Bissau to be one. So it's a clandestine meeting in Guinea-Bissau and Guinea, and few people get together, his brother, himself, and a few others. They're in their 30s, mostly assimilated formally, and mostly coming from Cape Verde. They formed the party. Cabral is in and out of the country, because at this time, he's also working as an agronomist. He's not yet full-time in the struggle. So they make a decision in the urban areas that they will infiltrate different organizations, legal organizations. Cabral is under the impression and is hoping that Guinea-Bissau can gain independence peacefully. And I think he's looking especially at Nkrumah, but he's also looking at, right next door to him, Guinea, Conakry, under Sekou Touré. And most of French-speaking Africa, all of it, gets their freedom peacefully. And most of English-speaking Africa as well. So they are infiltrating legal organizations, and one of the most important are the dock workers. Cabral uses Marxist language, but he's not a Marxist. But he's influenced by this idea that the working class can somehow be a leading force. But he's influenced by Nkrumah's idea that the struggle can achieve results peacefully. So they have a strike. Dock workers have a strike. And there is the belief that with this strike, with the proper organization of the people, the Portuguese will grant independence. This was a serious underestimation of the Portuguese, but it's understandable, because you don't want to go to armed struggle unless you have to. It's bloody, it's vicious. And so 50 dock workers are murdered. And so for Cabral, any death was a catastrophe for him. And so they realized they made a serious mistake. Cabral comes back, and he begins to put his full time into organizing. He goes into Guinea, Conakry, Guinea, under Sekou Touré. He has trouble at first getting Sekou Touré to support him, and it takes longer for him to get Senegal to support him, because these are two geographically adjoining areas to Guinea-Bissau. So he begins then to do his work. So he concludes as a result, and his party concludes, which at this point is small, that liberation will not come in the cities. It will not come through workers. They have hardly any. It will come through the countryside, through farmers, what they call peasants. Mao Zedong reaches the same conclusion, but, you know, through different process, because Mao also had a problem with his party people, who thought that they could win in the urban areas. And Mao had a saying, he said, the Chinese, and you're talking about Chinese communists, they think that Russian doo-doo smells good. So Mao, they have a long march in China where they're trying to wipe out the Chinese Communist Party. And in the course of that, Chou Enlai, who had been in charge of the Chinese Communist Party, turns leadership over to Mao Zedong because Mao has got the right strategy, the peasants. And Cabral gets the right strategy on his own, not from China. Cabral now realizes his major conclusion was, we cannot export a revolution. We can't copy what anyone else did. We're going to have to come up with our own thing and our own way. And it's going to have to be through the farmers.
Interesting. Fascinating, actually. All right, so talk to me about some of the distinctive approaches to organizing that Cabral used in organizing PAIGC and the farmers in the countryside. And then how are these methods that he produced, how can they apply to the U.S. today?
Yeah. So, you know, when Cabral comes back, he has nothing. He's going to Guinea. He has a house in Conakry with his wife. He has no arms, no money. He has the name Party for the Independence of Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde. And he has the people who formed it. And then the people who come in are people who survived the killing on the docks. He then begins to have young people who had come from the countryside, who were farmers, into the city, and who had no firm family ties. They were not married, been living at home, and they were occasional workers. And so they come, some of them come and join him. And then he has a few who had served in the Portuguese army. One had been an officer in the Portuguese army, which is unusual for an African. One, a civil servant. He had a few of these assimilated Africans who he also brings in. Now, at this time, Cabral, by this time, has traveled to China. Cabral had been in and out of Ghana. And
still in his 30s or moving toward his 40s?
He's in his 30s.
Okay.
He had been in and out of Ghana even before he organizes PAIGC, and had been in Angola when the MPLA, Movement for the Popular Liberation of Angola, was formed. He was one of the formers of it. And they actually created a coordinating body for all of the armed struggles in the Portuguese colonies. He is aware of what's going on in Algeria. Algeria had had an armed struggle, so he was aware of that. He was aware of what was happening in Cuba and would go back and forth and speak at what were called tricontinental conferences, where Castro would convene conferences because they had also had an armed struggle, though brief, in Cuba. So, and he was also aware that African independent states were having trouble, and he was looking at them. And when Nkrumah's overthrown, he's Nkrumah's favorite visitor because he's now based in Guinea, Conakry, and is made honorary president along with Sekou Touré, who's president of Guinea in Conakry. So when he's forming the party, he's thinking about all of this, okay? It's a 2-year period that he goes through of training people, 2 years. And he's training people, some of whom couldn't read and write. He teaches them how to read and write. Oh. None of whom had any political background. They didn't know the first thing about how colonialism worked. They just knew that the Portuguese were bad. They wanted them out of their country, you know? Cabral, so he has an approach to leadership training that is, first of all, personal. Cabral being a humane person. And really, that's an expression of African culture, but it's also his personality. He had personal interest and care for people. And so Cabral's first thing was always to take an interest in each person, in their lives, what their problems were. And as any good organizer, Cabral was a good listener. And so he would listen and then build on what people had to say. And then in the course of that, systematic training. And in the beginning, they slept in his house with his wife. And over time, they got a little place to stay. They didn't have any money in the beginning. And by the way, most struggles are organized without much money. San Francisco Freedom Movement, we didn't have any money. You know what I mean? So the point is, then Cabral begins systematic training. And it's interesting. The people that he trains during this two-year period, because others would be trained later on, not all by him, these are the people who rise to the highest levels of leadership in PAIGC. They're the ones. They end up running the country later. So it's the systematic training they get that is the most important thing. Cabral is placing a primary emphasis on transformation of mind, or what he calls mental conversion. And especially for those who are assimilated and can be the elite. But he's afraid that any of them can become the elite, because if they end up with the power to run that country, they could become exploiters.
Okay.
So his concern is to shape a revolutionary consciousness where these people he's training will serve the people. Now, his leadership training is very practical. Cabral did a little bit of acting himself. And so he would put people in sociodramas. We did this in Corps as well. And they would act out what they would do if they went to a village. And they would study how that village was organized based on Cabral's study of the social structure. And very often he was sending people back to the areas in which they were born. And so they understood how those societies were organized. So they would dress the way the people dressed. They would talk the people's talk. And so they had sociodramas until they got it down to the best approach for appealing to the people to win them over. So that this was like the key thing. And then it was a long process. It was hard to win the people over. It didn't occur overnight. It was hard, real hard. So this was his overall approach. It was very practical. He always reminded people, people wanted improvements in their lives. How does this apply to us? Leadership training and organizing training is absolutely essential. Ella Baker, that was really key to her approach to organizing. Ella Baker used interactive leadership training as an organizer, in training others as organizers, and believed that the local level was the most important level to organize on. In my case, particularly in forming Pan-African People's Organization, we used the process of reconstruction of the Black mind, the sixfold stages to mental freedom, taking people through an 8-month transformation process. It could be longer or shorter, and always suiting the process to the people, that is, to their level of consciousness. Always find out what level they're at, and then gear the training to that level. And then we combine mental conversion with organizing work. Because again, you don't complete it unless you're doing stuff for your people. So our people could be running a food program. They could be out organizing in the community. They could be selling newspapers. They could be giving away free clothes. They could be going to Africa and doing work. But there was work always associated with the transformation. Uh-huh. And I would say in our group, the people who are the best are the ones that underwent the deepest transformation. Some of those have been with me now 40, 45 years. And these are people that I don't have any problem about worrying about if my back is covered. I don't need to worry about, am I going to get infiltrated through them? They're the eyes and ears for anybody that wants to infiltrate. And they're all leaders. Uh-huh. They all run stuff. And they all think they're smarter than me. And they are. They are. I mean, some of them, Mustadi and Thabiti, real good at math. I'm not science. I'm not, you know what I mean? So I know. And they'll remind me. And then some think they're better at business than me. Now, some of them just specialize in it. The proof of the pie is in the pudding. I won't get embarrassing on this one. But yes, some specialize in more and spend their life on that. That's not me, but you know, that's a part. So leadership training's absolutely essential, and it's got to be practical, and it's got to be transformational. And so I didn't do this because Cabral, I didn't know when we set up our sixfold stages of training, I didn't know Cabral had gone through this. I found this out later. Just like I didn't know that Malcolm had gone through his when I went through mine. But once I find out, he's a good model.
Absolutely. So talk to me about how does Cabral, or how would Cabral view the six flow stages to mental freedom and creating a revolutionary African state of government? And can this system be used for Africa today?
Yeah, Cabral was really worried, and he had good reason to be worried. He was worried that when the armed struggle succeeded, that you could end up with Africans assuming power, and they would be PAIGC people, probably, running the country, who turned it into a racket.
Uh-huh.
He was concerned about that, because he saw that happening all over Africa. It was just beginning to happen. And so he was trying to figure out, how can you prevent this from happening? And so one of the things that he saw that was very important was the mental conversion piece that we talked about, sixfold stages. There had to be transformation in the course of struggle. So that was part of it. Part of it is, and the real important thing that I think that he got a real good handle on was that the people had to be involved in making their own decisions. And so democracy was real important. Even though the party also made certain decisions, like they would give commands for where the army would strike. And Cabral was the one writing up all those commands, interestingly enough. But at the same time, even when strike orders came about what Portuguese column to attack or what fort to attack or whatever, the people would go through endless debate over. Because in the end, the people were the ones making the decision. The people were the ones that could die as a result of this. And so Cabral saw one of the greatest achievements of the armed struggle was creating village committees where the people made the basic decisions at the village level. And this was a real important decision. 40% of all those village committees had to consist of African women. Could be more than 40%, but nearly half. And that's going against what it becomes colonial policy, where men get preferred over women. Women do all the work, and the men are up there laying around doing nothing.
Uh-huh.
And so this was extremely important. And so at the village level, there was an interaction between the party and the village committees. And these village committees really determine the success or failure of the struggle. So Cabral saw mental conversion as key, particularly for those that had been assimilated. And then he saw that integrating the party with the people and seeing that the people were always in a position where they could criticize the party. And the party couldn't go off and just make decisions on their own. So this was really key. And by the way, these changes occurred as a result of terrible crimes that got committed in the early period of the armed struggle, where certain Balanti leaders became militarists. And they were very successful in the armed struggle, but became very oppressive of the people. Cabral had to call a Congress inside of Guinea, and all of these little chumps came with their armed guards. He disarmed all of them, put them on trial, and shot them. And Cabral very rarely shot anybody. But in this case, that was a necessary measure, because once they cleaned that mess up, they reorganized the party and saw the need for involving the people in every level. So again, just as the mistake around the dock workers getting shot leads them to make the correct decision about basing the struggle in the countryside, so the quick organizing, because while it took a long time to win the people, after a while, it went so fast that people around Cabral didn't have control. And they were successful, but it got to a point where these little military commanders thought they could operate on their own, and they were doing terrible things. So that led to correction. So some of the mistakes actually led to an improvement in how the party was organized.
Fascinating. Wow. This is incredible. Talk to me about how Cabral used the sense of time to structure a revolutionary society, and the role the villagers played in the process as well.
Yeah, this is really important, and it's just recently caused me to appreciate more how important this is. Cabral believed that the society could not be transformed if that transformation did not occur during the course of the struggle. Now, transformation could occur afterwards, but it was really key that in the course of the struggle for independence, the armed struggle, that basic changes in how the society was organized occur during the course of the armed struggle. So Cabral saw having time as a ally. In other words, the longer the struggle took, the more time you would have to figure out how to restructure a society from a colonial one where a few people are making decisions to one where the people are involved and empowered in making decisions. So he saw time as an essential factor that you had to use. And so in the course of it, Cabral was thinking through, because up through the early 70s, as they become more and more successful in their armed struggle, Cabral is thinking about how's the government gonna work. And he's saying he's not gonna become president. He wants to be head of the party. And then he's saying, we don't need to have a big capital, you know, some big palace where a president resides. He was talking about having government under a tree or decentralizing ministries so that the ministries operated in the villages. So he was trying to rethink how government would work in a way that it would work for the people. But time was the key factor. So this was like key to how Cabral saw that.
So this is great. So talk to me about then the successful, how successful was Cabral with PAIGC in terms of military campaigns against the Portuguese, and how did he, you know, structure these military campaigns?
Okay, before going to that, I want to also make another point that for us, time is very important. And the more you free your mind, then the more you can understand that you shouldn't put all your time just into your immediate situation. We need to deal with the immediate. We need to deal with police violence, whatever the issues are people have. We need short-term programs to deal with that. But some of us also need, while we're dealing with the short-term, to deal with the long-term. Usually you have to have a mindset to think like that, because some of us are under so much pressure that we, you know, and so many of us empower the white boys so much that we don't think it's there's any reason for doing that. Because, you know, we don't think that anything's going to happen down the road. But the truth is, if we're going to change society, we have to do the planning for changing that now.
Absolutely.
One of the things that happened in the 60s is the power structure realized something. There was a real movement going on among black people, and they came in and stomped on it every possible way. That's why drugs hit the community, a whole lot of other things. But they realized their whole card was this. we hadn't thought through what would take the place of this thing that oppresses us. And if you wait until you're free to do it, you're going to end up doing the same thing you were doing before, which is what's happening in Africa right now. So we have got to place, if not as much time on the future, a lot of time on the future. And I put a lot of time on the future, but I deal in the present. I'm engaged and organized, I'm doing stuff, but that's not the whole thing. So we have to take time as our advantage, to our advantage. But the key point is, if we understand that this power called the United States of America is in decline, it's going down. And the thing is, we gotta ask, what's gonna come in its place? There's a demographic shift going on. Black, brown, red, and yellow gonna be a majority soon. That doesn't mean we'll be running the country, but it means that we should. Think about that one. And what we need to be doing is empowering our people to run stuff instead of being run. And so if you look at my works, Sixfold Stages, that's about how do you free minds so people can do that? The book that we talked about a couple of weeks ago about twin lineal families, that's about how can we reconfigure relationships between males and females so there's not abuse going on. And so that, you know, we can share our resources so that we can empower ourselves, build our own businesses, and take control of our community. Starts at the family level. So we got to think in terms of shifting the paradigm, shifting the models. The books I'm working on now on mastery, that's a replacement system for this bad miseducation system. That's not just because we need a system that teaches us our history and culture. We need the method for teaching. How do we free minds? Not just around the sixfold stages of consciousness, but around mastery. How do we take people who are novices but got gifts and take them to the highest level? How do we do that? How do we take people that can bring this cosmos into harmony? Because it's out of harmony now. You know what I mean? So we got to think about that. And then test it until it works. You know? So going to the military campaigns. What's amazing about Cabral is he was a master thinker, master organizer, but also he was the chief architect of their armed struggle. Now, it's one thing to be the chief architect. It's another thing to be the successful chief architect. Churchill in World War II was constantly insistent on a lot of harebrained ideas that got a lot of people killed, especially World War I.
Oh.
World War I, one of his big campaigns, got a lot of people killed. You know what I mean? Churchill was no military strategist. Yeah, he had fought in a few little oppressive wars. He was a colonist, you know? So it's one thing to be in charge of the military. It's another thing to be successful. Here's the overall thing with Cabral. First of all, he was in charge of all the major campaigns. And I was reading something by Basil Davidson, because he's a European historian. It's the first one that I read on African history, Lost Cities of Africa. He spent time in Guinea-Bissau. And so and one of the things I was reading was directions coming from Cabral on military strikes. And it's about 16 different things they're supposed to do. So-and-so, so-and-so is to blow up this bridge, blah, blah. So-and-so, so-and-so is supposed to attack vehicles that come along this road. So-and-so. But the point is this. Here's the proof. The pie is, you know, the proof of the pie is in the pudding. Now, what's the pudding? At the maximum, the Portuguese had 50,000 people engaged in their war. They had to constantly increase it because over and over, Cabral's people were defeating them. So they kept bringing in more soldiers. Maximum, Cabral had 10,000 people. 10,000 against 50,000. Oh. That's the nature of guerrilla warfare. But Cabral had this rule that in an engagement, that if you lost more than one person, that was a catastrophe. So not only do they defeat the Portuguese militarily, what they do is, first of all, through ambushes and stuff like that, they drive them into their forts, and then they drive them into cities. So Cabral, in over a period of time, gains control of the countryside. So much so he's able to bring the UN in, and the UN documents the fact that he's basically got the country, just a few cities and forts that he doesn't have. Then the Portuguese go to the air, and so they start bombing you. First with helicopters, and they had these trained African puppets who came and tortured people. You know, they were terrible. So they got anti-aircraft material guns, and at a certain point, it would shoot down high aircraft. Now that's when Portugal was finished at that point. And how they transported the country wasn't easy because he didn't have a lot of motorized equipment. But so the point is, Cabral drives them to the point that they are confined to limited areas. Now, the key point, here's the proof of the pie. Cabral's soldiers killed between 10 and 20,000 Portuguese. We don't know how many Africans, but probably more. He loses between 1 and 2,000 soldiers by death. Wow. Who's ever heard of those odds?
Wow.
You hear me?
Wow, that's a master strategist.
So, and that was because he was also a kind person, and he didn't really like bloodshed at all. And this, the other thing is, Cabral had a policy against terrorism. Terrorism is where you just use indiscriminate violence. Cabral's policy was they would kill no Portuguese women or children. And that was known. Even though the Portuguese raped, killed, and did everything else that was
uh-huh, uh-huh.
He didn't do that. And over time, that led to a great respect among the Portuguese. And when they captured the Portuguese, they treated them with respect. That didn't happen when they got caught, you know? So it was this humanism that was extremely important that in part contributed to the low casualty. The other thing is, practicing guerrilla warfare, Cabral's military units packed a punch. And so he would have bazookas, rocket launchers, machine guns. His ideal unit was about 20. That was their favorite unit. When they moved to what they call mobile warfare, then they would have a unit of 200. They would pack an even bigger punch. So when you hit somebody by surprise who's coming down a road and you hit them with a bazooka, you know, you hit them with rockets, you hit them with machine guns, it's all over. So this was the nature of the armed struggle. But Cabral never saw the liberation of Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde occurring through the armed struggle. He's meaning, if it occurred through the armed struggle, you would have to defeat the Portuguese army. He never saw them defeating the Portuguese army. He saw them inflicting such heavy blows on them that they would have to give up and reach a political settlement, which is what happened.
Okay, so now talk to me about this. In terms of Cabral's biggest obstacle to achieving a revolutionary independence in Guinea-Bissau and in Africa, and also talk to me about the effect of Cabral's assassination and how did that affect, on the eve of his assassination, how did that affect the minds of the movement?
Yeah, Cabral was first...
How old was he when he was assassinated?
He was assassinated in 1973, and he was born in 1920-something, so do the math. What was he born? He was born 1924, so was assassinated in 1973. So not yet 50, so it was late 40s. As I said before, Cabral saw the problem of independence being a racket, meaning the people who come to power using their power position to enrich themselves and to oppress the people. Cabral took the position that Guinea-Bissau was a poor country. It was small. And so it may never be rich unless they discovered raw materials and they would see. But that what they had to do was diversify agriculture. That what they had to do was to increase the productivity of agriculture, but to produce a wide variety of crops that could feed the people and could also be used for export. So had he come to power, that would have been his first emphasis, and that's correct, because you cannot build into an industrial base until you have a strong agricultural base. And the reason why China is smoking right now is when Deng Xiaoping came to power. He told the Chinese farmers that they could do whatever they wanted to do in terms of growing crops and setting prices. And what happened is the productivity exploded. And then around that, they could build the economic infrastructure. So Cabral saw that, and Nyerere saw that in Tanzania, the villages we worked in. He saw agriculture was the first thing. Too many independent African countries wanted to go for the big industrial projects first. And the problem with that is you didn't have a base for it. You're probably begging for foreign aid to get the money to build it. But the problem also was you were robbing the countryside in order to build that. Because whatever you put of your wealth into it came from agriculture. But the benefits were not going back to the farmer. And so Cabral was very clear about that, you know, that you had to deal with the agriculture first. Fortunately, after he's assassinated, his brother comes to power and he begins to put emphasis on Mickey Mouse industrial projects in the city, like he has an automobile plant located in the capital, a Citroën plant. Citroëns don't even sell good in Europe, you know what I mean? And what do Africans need with automobiles at that point? I mean, I know that's prestigious for us here, but Guinea-Bissau, most of the roads weren't paved. I mean, what's the point of this? So that was one thing. The major thing he was wrestling with, and he had a good appreciation for the time, but he didn't have a full appreciation because it would take later to fully understand what he was up against. He was up against the European nation state and the fact that with independence, no leader questioned the European nation state model being used as a model for governing Africa. So you ended up with parliamentary systems in places like Ghana. And you ended up with justices who are going to court with white wigs on, imitating the European model, not understanding. And Cabral was the most far-sighted in terms of seeing this, but he didn't have the full picture because it would take longer. Had he lived longer, he would have got the full picture. But he didn't understand fully that the reason that the European and the European American nation state is no good for Africa is it is based on the John Locke Montesquieu model. And you'll find this by reading the second treatise on government by John Locke. John Locke is a British political thinker. The American government is based on John Locke and Montesquieu was a French political thinker. But John Locke's system is based on one thing. Government is for the purpose of protecting private property. And what property are you talking about? Big business. Now for Locke, big business had not reached the level it had reached, but the notion of private property, he means the land and the resources that come from the land. Africans had no notion of that. Their notion was the air, the land, and the water is owned by the people. And so as a result, when you get a John Locke system installed, that's a system for exploitation because it's protecting property interests. What main interest? It's the interests outside, the interests of Europe. So if you got gold mines and you don't free your own mine, you end up letting the British have in your gold mines, as it's happened in Ghana. You understand? Or you end up transferring your raw materials to the West and getting very little back in return. And you end up buying their stuff that's a finished product that comes from your stuff, when you should be finishing your own stuff, but you're not ready to do that. You need to build your agriculture first. So the point is, the nation state, as the European has created it, is one designed for corruption. And we think there's checks and balances. No, there's not. There's no checks, there's no balances. Those with power rule. The head of the Continental Congress, when he was asked, who should rule America? He said, those who own it should rule it. And so when people talk about the Congress is controlled by all these campaign donations, the Congress is controlled by the people who own the country. They own the Congress. They own the president. They own the Supreme Court. You understand? They own it. So the thing is, Cabral was seeing what was wrong. He didn't get the whole picture because he hadn't had time to see the whole picture, but he was as close as you could get for his time. And he saw that it had to be a restructuring that took place. Notice King's conclusion, Martin Luther King, by the end of his life. He said, the problem with America is structural.
Ooh.
It's structured to make the rich rich and the poor poor. And what did Malcolm say? He said, America's no more designed to produce freedom than a chicken is designed to produce a duck egg. He said, if a chicken could produce freedom, it would be a revolutionary chicken. And if a duck egg could produce freedom, it would be a revolutionary duck egg. The point is, Malcolm was saying the same thing King was saying. The system's going to have to be restructured. And the first restructuring is of the mind. So Cabral was in the process of figuring it out. So when you lost him, you lost the creativity. I'm going to tell you, in terms of revolution, in terms of leaders, a Cabral is a rarity. You can train people all you want, but someone like him, he's rare, rare. And so as a result, unfortunately, what followed him didn't have the creativity that he had.
So looking at him as literally the greatest leader in the 20th century, what can we learn from him and how can we apply what we have learned and what you are sharing with us about Cabral? How can we apply that today?
The biggest thing is, if your leaders haven't reached the stage of revolutionary consciousness, watch out. They're not true revolutionaries. And that I mean it in the most important sense, in the humane sense. Because for transformation for African people, the first concern has got to be the people, which means power has to be decentralized. And so I think that with Cabral, what he was doing in the villages, he was doing the right thing. And in fact, that's how traditional African governments work. At the national level, the national, if you had kings and queens, they had virtually no say-so over what happened in the villages. The villages made their own decisions. And they determined what crops they grew. They determined what they produced, what the price was. What the king got was a little tax, usually off of gold if it was in Ghana. He got the big nuggets and, you know, the smaller stuff the people had. But the point, and in traditional Africa, before the coming of Islam and Christianity, you didn't have standing armies. Because the state as a concept is an institution of violence. That is, a state is the army and the police. And why do they have army and police? It's the European system. They say it's to protect you from those on the outside. No, it's to protect them from you. Because they're ripping you off. So they got to have, why they got the police shooting black people right and left? To keep us in our place. You understand? Why they got this huge military industrial complex? They're worried about the time that people, not just black, brown, red, yellow, even some whites, figure out they're fed up. They're wondering when it's going to happen. And so the thing is, when you have a just society, you don't need no standing army of any size. yeah, you'd eat something. And in Ghana, it was a militia. So everybody was prepared to fight if someone invaded their country. Uh-huh. But it wasn't a standing army, you know? So I think one of the things we can learn is that we've got to transcend the systems we live under to figure out how do we construct things that are just. And so how do we really construct just family relationships? I think that's at the foundation, because the foundation of revolution is family. John Henry Clark really appreciated that. If you look at Malcolm, when he evolved most importantly around his idea about African and African-American women and his relationship to women, which was never, once he woke up, exploitative, but he improved on himself when it came to that. Uh-huh. So, you know, I think that that's one of the things that we can get from him, that you can't transform society unless you transform yourself. And the question is, how do we work that transformation? Cabral hoped that the sixfold stages to mental freedom would do it as part of it. And I think he was right. Had he had enough time, he was right. But even then, he realized that in the awakening process, part of this is moral. And so you can awaken to African consciousness. You can love yourself and your people. But are you going to commit yourself to sacrifice yourself for your people? I don't mean kill yourself, but are you going to really place the people's interests first? That's a moral issue. Uh-huh. You know what I mean? So the people have that. So one of the real great things about Malcolm and King is they valued their people before money. One of the real great things about African-American culture is it's taught us to value our people before money. Now with this hip-hop generation, too many have been brainwashed with this idea that money is the first thing. Well, first of all, they're broke. So all this talk about money is the first thing and you haven't got any anyway.
Uh-huh.
Where's that leading you?
Uh-huh.
And if you think you are, you're kidding yourself in most cases, because your idea, if you're not working with your people to improve your condition, chances are if you got a hustle, it's petty and penny ante.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
These pimps, these armed robbers, they end up all in jail. All of them assume that they're going to jail. What kind of robber are you? You know what I mean? The real robbers, they run the jails. They run the banks. You go rob their bank, and let's say you get $100,000 and you don't. You rob the till. You don't rob the bank. You don't go into the safety deposit vault. What happens? They report to their insurance company that you got $300,000. You ain't hurting them at all. You know what I mean? So, I mean, if you think that sticking somebody up is a big deal, well, the stick-up system is America the pimp, and that's called capitalism. That's going to hurt some people, but that's what it is. And we built it through slavery. You understand? We made them rich through slavery. So what I'm saying is we got to transcend their reality. Just as our people did in slavery, we came out of mud. But we didn't let mud get inside of us. And so we created something new and beautiful, a culture that has sustained us, that needs to be strengthened by us digging from into our deep African past. So I think that Cabral shows us we got to, whatever we do, be our best at it and make sure that we place our people in it and that we're doing something to help our people, to support our people. We got homeless people right now. Homeless people in the richest country on this planet, living in tents. And some of them don't even have tents. Got old women running around pushing these carts that come out of supermarkets with all their possessions in it.
Uh-huh.
I was down on the street last week and a sister's in a wheelchair crying. You know what I mean? And I went up to her and I said, is anything wrong, sister? No, no. And then I came back and she said, can you help me? And I gave her $40. And boy, her eyes just popped open. But I don't feel good about doing that. Because $40, how far is that going to go? Why are people, old people like her, laying out on the street? Because there's a system that doesn't care 2 cents about anything other than the rich and the strong. And so the question is, what do we care about? And, you know, I think that Cabral, Malcolm, Ella Baker, sisters in Black Lives Matter, and the brothers, anyone who's committed to something bigger than themselves, Cabral has given us an idea of how to be effective in carrying out that commitment.
Wow. Thank you for this, Dr. Oba T’Shaka on Amílcar Cabral. Absolutely enlightening. This conversation and this lesson needed to be had. I appreciate you.
Appreciate you, brother. And as I say to all the people out there, this is the black genius of YouTube and the internet. They call him the Oprah Winfrey. Hell, he's more than that. He's the genius. This young man has got a whole lot of insight into stuff, and I'm appreciative. And he hasn't just put this out just to put it out. It means something to him. So,
absolutely.
I appreciate you and love you.
I love you too, Doc. Give love to the Queen, Hotep family, Hotep Dr. O.
Same to you.